baptism is really, really important. What I like about our worship space is that we have a baptismal font that is sturdy. It is here. It is a good reminder that baptism is central to our identity as followers of Jesus. Maybe you've been in some churches like I have where the baptismal font is really kind of a bowl where you could put some frosted flakes and some milk and you could enjoy it. I've been in a congregation, maybe you have been too, where you have the communion table. By the way, we talked about this with our confirmation students last time. This is not an altar, it is a table. We don't offer sacrifices any longer. We gather together at this table. So anyway, pastor said, okay, here's the altar. Yeah, okay, whatever. And then he pulled out on a shelf the baptismal font, which is about that big, and so it was hidden. Again, I love the fact that in our worship space, there is a big, bad, bold baptismal font that reminds us of how important it is. My first congregation was in Toledo, All Saints Church. If you've been to Toledo, it was pretty close to the corner of Reynolds Road and Heather Downs Boulevard. It was a long time ago. Back in the day, there was a mall called the Southwick Mall. If you're a student of history, you might remember that. It's no longer there. While I was at All Saints, I became good friends with a man named Dwayne. Dwayne was in his 50s. He was brilliant. He was a person of deep faith, a teacher in our congregation. Dwayne was one of those people with whom I felt I could be safe and vulnerable and share things with him and it would be okay. Dwayne was also an editor at the Toledo Blade, which we used to call one of America's great fish wraps. And so I loved the Blade. In fact, there were people who came out at 8:15 and 9:30 who recalled reading the Toledo Blade. I'm just having fun with the Blade. I know this is sir. They still read the Blade? God bless them. Okay, anyway, pardon me? They're the last ones. Yeah, that's right. Anyway, look online. The Blade might be there, though. Maybe not. It is Holy Toledo, after all. I love Toledo, too, by the way. So anyway, Dwayne and I would meet downtown at a place called My Brother's Place, which was a soup and sandwich joint inside a beautiful Episcopal church. I'd often go down and chat with Dwayne about whatever happened to be on my mind at that moment, and he would listen patiently. And that particular day, he said, so what are you thinking about? So I told Dwayne that I was thinking about this story, the story of the baptism of Jesus. And I said, you know, Dwayne, I wonder why it is that God doesn't speak to us anymore. And I wonder how people would respond if I said to them that I had heard God speak to me. How would they respond? I just wish somehow it was more clear. Well, Dwayne, who had been in the church a long time, said, Brad, God speaks to me lots. Every time I'm in worship on Sunday, my pastor tells me that God loves me, and I see it in the scripture, and I see it in my relationships, and I see it and I hear it all the time. But here's what I think, Brad. I think that we don't want to hear God speaking to us because when we do, it might frighten us. It might frighten us. Dwayne said, I think it frightens us because for God to speak to us today and to say that we are already well, that God is already well pleased with us, means that we don't dictate the terms of our relationship with God. We don't get to decide who God is. It is God who decides to say to us, I am well pleased with you. He said we also lose a lot of control because we would love to tell God with whom God ought to be well pleased and with whom God shouldn't be well pleased, and we would love to do that, but we can't. We have no control in our relationship with God. God decides. God says what God will say about us, and that might frighten us because it means right here, right now, nothing done, God is well pleased with us. So this morning, invite us to kind of sit back and take a deep breath and hear some words spoken by God to us. You are my son. You are my daughter, chosen and marked by my love, pride of my life. How's it feel to you when you hear those words, when you breathe them in, when you receive them from a God that you were not able to control, from a God who calls the shots in God's relationship with us? How does it feel? Well, I think sometimes that when we hear these words, we sort of move into the mode of my brother-in-law, John, who was a chemical engineer until recently. He just retired. John traveled all over the country. He was a plant manager working closely with the paper industry, chemistry, paper, all of that, Kentucky and New York and Wisconsin and Ohio, all over the place. John, as a good engineer, would often say, you got to work the problem. You got to work the problem. You work it hard enough. You work it smart enough. You work it long enough. You work it well enough. You'll find a solution, and then you'll succeed if only you will work the problem. The problem is that that's not life. Problem is that there are times when we work problem, think the problem through, manage the problem, and we don't succeed. Things don't quite turn out the way that we hope they would. You have a crisis in your marriage and you try to manage it, and it doesn't quite turn out the way you'd like it to. You have a situation that at work and you want to manage it and succeed, but you don't. Our beautiful, beloved, cherished granddaughter, Quinn, was born on April 16th of last year. She'll be a year, April 16th. Quinn came into the world with some challenges. Quinn came into the world with some challenges that are going to be with her for the rest of her life. And when those challenges became known to us, I think a lot of us kind of moved into the working the problem mode. I know I did. I remember for about a week after she was born, I would go to bed and literally not sleep. I would lay in bed literally in a cold sweat, trying to figure out what I could do to work the problem, trying to figure out what I could do to fix it, to manage it. And there was nothing. Quinn is doing well today, and she will have a good life. It was a difficult time for all of us. We know that she is beloved. We know that she is the pride of God's life. And yet trying to manage the problem, work the problem, brought many of us to our knees, and so we failed. And when you fail, I think, at least I do, I start to wonder, okay, God, you say I'm the pride of your life, but am I really still? You say that I've been marked and chosen, but am I really still? Because I'm not a good manager, haven't solved the problem, and I have failed. One of the hard-earned lessons that I'm still trying to figure out, and probably never will completely, is that when I shut up and when I sit down and when I let go of trying to manage the problem, I can hear God's voice saying, I'm the healer. I'm going to do the work for you. You can't do it. You were the pride of my life. Feel like a failure. Maybe you are, maybe you failed, but it doesn't matter to me. And so God is still speaking, but often it's when we are driven to our knees. It's often when we are driven to despair and maybe then we can listen, and maybe we can hear God speaking in some ways that other times we can't. And so God spoke to me in the midst of all of that, and God was assuring about our granddaughter, and we know that. We are confident in that. One of the things that I love about the story of the baptism of Jesus, and it's not written there, but I think it's true. Don't know if you notice, but when the Holy Spirit descends like a dove and God says, "You are my son with whom I am well pleased, pride of my life," Jesus hasn't done anything yet. Hadn't walked on water, hasn't fed 5,000, hasn't hung out with sinners and tax collectors and prostitutes, hasn't walked on water, hasn't done any of that, and God is already well pleased with Jesus before he has done a darn thing. Jesus, the human one, the Son of Man, is loved and embraced fully before Jesus has done anything. Identity is established. Love is established regardless of what he will eventually do. You know what I love about infant baptism? Lutheran Christians baptize infants. We also baptize people of a lot of other ages. If you've been around a while, you've seen adult baptisms here. You've seen teenage baptisms. What I love about infant baptism, which is why it's so foundational, is that if you look at this child, he's having a blast. He doesn't know what's happening to him. He doesn't know that God is saying, "You're the pride of my life." Not going to remember this experience, as far as we know. Doesn't control the terms of the relationship. Doesn't get to say, "No, God, I'd rather not be the pride of your life." It is happening to this child, just as it happens to us, but we still want to manage the terms of the relationship. Let go and let God can be trite. It's something that folks in AA say a lot. And if you are a parent or a friend of someone that you deeply love, letting go and letting God can be a really hard thing. I'm aware of some parents in our congregation whose children are fully into the whole heroin opioid piece, and it scares the hell out of them. I know parents in our congregation whose children have not done as well as they wish they would have in school. Universities close by and far away. You know when you let go and you let God that it's a hard thing, and that to trust that God will always say to your son or daughter, always say to your good friend, "You're the pride of my life," that's a hard thing to do, to let go and to let God. And yet Isaiah, which was the reading at 8:15 and 9:30, says, God says, "I'm going to walk with you through all of it. Do not be afraid. I am with you. I have called you each by name, and you are mine." We don't control God's decision. God makes that decision for us. Remember who you are. It's been kind of fun throughout the morning. At 8:15, a fellow in the congregation came out, and he said, "You know, when I started my freshman year at Capital University, and my parents dropped me off, the last thing my dad said to me was, 'Remember who you are.'" Pretty cool. Another woman at 9:30 came out and said that when they would get together with their family, her grandfather, the last thing he would say to all the kids and the grandkids is, "Remember who you are." That's pretty cool. Long time ago, 1994, there was a movie that came out called The Lion King. The Lion King is still getting some traction on Broadway, so I think people are paying attention to it. There's a scene in The Lion King that I think is so much about what God would have us do today.
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
Yourself, Simba. You are more than what you have become. You must take your place in the circle of life.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son and the one true king. Remember who you are.
No, please, don't leave me. Father!
Remember.
Don't leave me.
Remember.
Remember who God is. Remember who you are.